and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Delighted to be with you on this Tuesday afternoon. Maybe it's a Tuesday evening where you are, maybe even a Wednesday morning. Whatever time it is, we're glad you're spending it with us. Thanks for doing that. It's open forum, both hours today, open forum. If you've got a question about the Catholic faith, if you want to know about Jesus, if you want to know about the God the Father, the Holy Spirit, you want to know about the Bible, the sacraments, the moral life, whatever you want to know about, you're welcome to call. And you don't have to be Catholic to call. Anybody can call. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. If you're just driving along in the car and you're like, wow, man, it's a long drive to get back home from this from the eclipse. Then you're like, I've never heard this show before, but I've always had a question about those Catholics. Well, now's your opportunity. 888-318-7884. With us this hour, Tim Staples, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. The man made Catholic by Jimmy Swaggart. He's got a wonderful talk called Jimmy Swaggart Made Me Catholic, and he's the author of Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. Tim Staples, welcome.
Hey, it's good to be with you, brother.
Did you see the eclipse? Did the eclipse play any part in your life?
No, just online.
You looked online to see.
Yeah, I looked online. But we had my sister-in-law sent us videos from Texas where they live, and they were right smack dab in the middle of it, and it was just powerful. You know what's awesome is people were crying.
I that was the most, like, of all the stuff I saw, people's emotional reaction to it. I was like, all right, I think I've been a little casual about this. Next time I'm going to try to see it.
Yeah, like, I saw a science teacher who had taken his class on a field trip to view it. And they interviewed, this was some station in Texas. And he was tearing up, and people were all around. And it was funny because it seemed like this teacher was a very secular guy.
Yeah.
You know, he's a scientist. And the news reporter kept asking him, why do you think you're so emotional about this? And he was trying to give an answer, just keeping it to scientific facts. You could see he was trying.
That won't do it.
But it just doesn't do it. It was almost like he did not even understand why he was crying.
Yeah. You know? No, right.
You know, because, you know, to me, it was Psalm 19:1, right? The heavens declare the glory of God. And you saw that I was viewing this as it was moving. You know, we were looking online, and we got different perspectives from people in different states, you know. But you just got this sense of the heavens declare the glory of God, that this is a classic example of the beauty of the creation revealing the Creator.
Yeah,
because
right,
there's something obviously that transcends the scientific facts here that this teacher was trying to communicate, but it's revealing the fact that you cannot explain the order, the beauty inherent in the creation without the Creator.
right. And you can't explain that it's in your nature to respond to that.
Yes.
You know? 888-318-7884 is the number. Somebody said to me yesterday, you can see the next one. And I said, when's the next one coming here? And they said, 20 years. And I said, I'll probably have to see it from the backside. I'm going to be on the other side. I'll be on the other side of the eclipse. See what it looks like from that side. 888-318-7884 is the number, yeah.
And can I add something? Because speaking of beauty, how about the new document from the Vatican on transgender?
We were just talking about it, that I have not read it before program.
Well, let me tell you, brother, it's rich. You know me. I love Pope Francis, and I love the magisterial documents, and I know a lot of people, and it drives me crazy because I don't understand. I guess I sympathize, you know, because people hear blessing a homosexual couple, and they go crazy and say he's saying it's okay to bless the homosexual sin, and that is not what the Pope has said, that's not what the Vatican is saying. He's talking about people who are crying out to God to live the gospel better. And the blessing can be a part, an instrumental part of their journey to full conversion and such. But, you know, we've talked about that. But it drives me crazy because we're talking about, with Pope Francis, we're talking about a prophet here who is reaching out to the folks you're not supposed to reach out to and offering blessing and such where the church can. But here on with the transgender, that the document is beautiful because there's so much good in this document and beauty. I love, I believe it was section 59, where, you know, it talks about how right around there, 59. This is one you want to read more than once. I'm telling you that, brother. This is so rich. It's so good. But it talks about how you cannot say that the human body is somehow inferior to the person, right? And that the human body can be manipulated by the person or persons outside. Why? Because, of course, the church is teaching, as she has for 2,000 years, we are a hylomorphic being, a body-soul composite. The body-soul constitutes the person. The body is so, and you really get that in this document. It's beautiful the way that it is presented, because we're not a ghost in a machine. We're not, you know, the body, the soul trapped in this inferior body.
That's an awful image, isn't it?
This awful sort of thing that you have in the body to be manipulated, because, Si, you and I know that because the soul is the form of the body and the body is constitutive of the person, when a soul, the body is so integral to the person because we are a substantial being, body, soul, that is one thing. It's not even really two things. It's not. The body, soul constitutes one thing.
Yeah.
A substantial reality. We're not even talking about two things. Yes, there are two constitutive components, but those are not two things.
Right.
Because they constitute the thing itself. And so that's why we say when a person dies, as Ecclesiastes chapter 12 verse 7 says, when a person dies, his body goes back to the dust. The soul returns to God who gave it. When the soul is separated from the body like that, we say, yeah, there's a substantial reality to the soul in heaven or in purgatory, but it's an incomplete substance.
Right.
Right. Right. That's the language of philosophy. We try as best we can to use language to reveal the great mystery of the human person. But we have to say that, yeah, there's still a substantial reality when we're talking about the soul, because it cannot die. It lives on. But it's incomplete. And that's why we say that the souls in purgatory or the souls in heaven are souls. We don't say they are persons.
Right, right.
Why?
Because a human person is
constituted by a body-soul composite. That's the substantial being. So incomplete substance, not a person until the resurrection of the body, not fully a person. And so that's why, you know, Pope Francis has been so strong, and he caught flack, you know, for saying on numerous occasions that this transgender ideology is demonic. It's demonic. Why? Because it's trying to destroy the nature that God has made as such. And in the document of Psy, it says that this is an example of human beings trying to make themselves God.
That's wonderful. I'm
to
glad.
Try, yeah. And you cannot do that. You are failing. Oh, and we could do a couple of hours on this document, but there's so much good in it. But I love the part where it says that this so-called gender-affirming care surgery is absolutely contrary to human dignity, can never be permitted. This is something that is intrinsically evil.
Yeah.
It's contrary to the dignity of the human person. That's the kind of language used here is the same language the church uses with regard to abortion and euthanasia,
right.
Contraception. This is contrary to human dignity. And God bless the church for standing up. And of course, the pundits are all over the place, you know, going to attack the church. But ultimately, what we have to, I got to say this, Cy, what Holy Mother Church is doing, just as she is doing, our Holy Father is doing, when she's reaching out to folks who suffer with same-sex attraction and reaching out, yes, with blessing to anyone who is crying out for help, because we have a world, Cy, that has gone berserk. We have, a sexually crazed culture that has begun with the so-called sexual revolution, and we can go back before that, but in particular, the so-called sexual revolution that has left people in absolute despair. Cy,
yes,
people right. in so-called same-sex relationships, they're acting contrary to their nature. There is no peace there. And Holy Mother Church is trying to reach out to them like we did in Fiducia Supplicans, and unfortunately it gets hijacked, and you have people calling themselves Catholics who are attacking a document that is so beautiful and trying to reach out to these people. Well, this document on transgender, it reiterates the fact that we're not talking about crimes here. You know, we're not, when you're talking about transgender and people doing these things, we're not talking about crimes, and please, and it reiterates when it comes to the LGBTQRSTU alphabet people, whatever you want to call it, we're not talking about crimes, we're talking about sins. These are grave sins, and we have to attack it where it is, in the spiritual realm where we live, Cy Kellett, as Catholics, as Christians. We need to be proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ and reaching out to people, including these transgender people, because it's one thing, and I love the way the document says it, it's one thing to declare, yes, as Pope Francis has said, this is demonic stuff here, all right? But now what are we going to do? We've got to reach out to these people, many of whom have already been mutilated, Cy.
I know the horror and regret.
And there are millions more coming.
Yeah.
They're going to be mutilated. They're being encouraged to be mutilated. What are we going to do? We've got to reach out, and please, we have, and this document makes the distinction between the ideology and the people that are suffering. We've got to preach the gospel, but remember to love people with the truth. Never compromise the truth, because there's millions, and there's going to be millions more that are going to need our help. They already do. They need the truth, and praise God for the Vatican in this timely fashion, because this document has actually been years in the making. It wasn't something that
5 years or something.
Yeah,
like that,
five years in the making. This was not just thrown together here. But you know,
I got to read it.
Yeah,
I got to read
it. And everybody,
Dignitas Infinita is the name of the document.
Infinite dignity.
And you can just find it. Just search online. I kind of had a sense that I would like the document because CNN hated it.
Yeah.
So that was that's my entire basis on which to judge.
Well, you
so
know,
far.
Cy, when it comes to Fiducia Supplicans, CNN loved it. Until they found out what it actually says. As long as you have Catholics that are you know, misrepresenting it, they love it. Yes, we can attack the Catholics, and the Catholics are attacking the Catholics. But then once they find out what's actually in it, all of a sudden, Fiducia kind of disappears.
They don't want to talk about it anymore.
They don't want to talk about it, yeah.
All right, it's open forum. We'll take a very quick break right back with Tim Staples and your questions on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live. Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at magnificat.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I pray that EWTN News In Depth will help the everyday life of everyday Catholics by bringing them the news that matters to them and helping them to have the information at their fingertips for whatever it is that they need to be able to engage with the world confidently with their faith.
EWTN News In Depth with Montse Alvarado, Friday night, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Television and Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Same ad as yesterday. So if you heard the ad yesterday, you're going to get the same thing again. It's madness, I tell you, to celebrate the men's and women's college basketball championship. Congrats now to the UConn men. Oh, it's not the same ad because yesterday it was – is it South Carolina? The women?
Yeah, South Carolina. They beat Iowa.
We have a very – I'm going to start tearing up. Now that you said that, my favorite person, Caitlin, what's her last name?
Oh my gosh, she's Clark, right? Is it Clark?
Caitlin Clark, yeah. It's just so funny how everybody, she's a magnificent athlete.
Yeah.
But the truth is, most of us, we just heard of her like the last month.
That's right.
When you visit shop.catholic.com until midnight tonight, use the promo code MADNESS and get 20% off store-wide. And it's off in addition to any other sale that is going on right now at shop.catholic.com. All right, I better go to the phones.
Yes.
Manny's in Sacramento watching on YouTube. Manny, thanks for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Thank you. So Pope St. Damasus, the first decree, awesome document there against Protestantism and Eastern Orthodoxy.
Yes.
A lot of people have been saying that that decree of 382 is a forgery because I've seen multiple reasons. The only two main big reasons, I would say, is number one, it contains a mention of the Holy Spirit, and it's word for word exactly what's written in one of St. Augustine's writings, written 34 years afterward.
Right.
And the other argument is that Pope Nicholas I apparently made a declaration on the canon, and he referenced Pope St. Innocent I, but he didn't say anything about Pope Damasus I, who was an earlier pope. And I've been trying to find information on that one. I couldn't find anything. So,
right.
Yeah, that would be the questions, yeah.
Yeah, it's a great question, and it is a question. There's not a definitive answer. It is certain that Pope Damasus did call the Synod of Rome in 382, and it's certain that he commissioned St. Jerome, and Jerome translated, or at least substantially translated, he used already extant manuscripts. He didn't, as some say, just start from scratch. That's not true. But he certainly did. Now, the canon itself has been attributed to numerous sources, as you know. And so there are some who attribute it to Damasus, some as late as Pope Gelasius, which I think is a bit of a stretch. So it's not absolutely certain. As far as I know, scholarship is still kind of up in the air on that. So, but when it comes to the actual canon itself, that's a different story. We have that infallibly settled by the Church.
Yeah. So this would be about how far back can we locate?
Exactly.
Yeah. Manny, thank you very much. I'm going to keep moving. Get as many on as I can with Tim. Justin is in Arkansas, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Justin, go ahead with your question for Tim.
Hi, good evening, Tim. I had a question for you, especially with your Protestant background. What is, the Catholic perspective of Protestant preachers and ministers being called to the ministry by God?
Yeah.
What is the validity of that, or, just general opinion?
Sure. Yeah, you've come to the right source here because I have personal experience on this. I remember when I converted to the Catholic faith back in 1988, I had already been working as a youth minister at an Assembly of God community, and I was in the process of earning my credentials with the Assemblies of God, so I believed that I was called to the ministry. And the church, and you'll find this across the board, you won't find a bishop that would even come close to arguing this point. They always respect the callings of those, you know, from various denominations and such, and treat them with respect. And then you dive in and you know, find out the particulars and such. And bishops have to discern whether, and this is true whether it's with, whether it's an Orthodox priest who has valid orders already, or whether it's a Protestant, whether there is a genuine call to the ministry. I believed I did have, and my bishop discerned it, and you know, it's not like you get a bolt from the blue. Yes, Tim Staples is called to the priesthood. Ah, right.
Yeah.
And so, no, but you know, in consultation with what who I always say was the greatest vocations director in the history of the United States, Father Jim Gould, in the Diocese of Arlington, consulting with him, and they kind of looked me over. They then allowed me to go into formation for the priesthood, where I spent 6 years in formation, and then I discerned I was not called, right? So, you know, there's not a sort of one-size-fits-all here, because I know of cases where I have a dear friend who was a validly ordained priest. He was ordained by a schismatic group before he became Catholic. And he wanted to, you know, be able to exercise his priesthood in the Catholic Church. He got a bishop. They made the petition. And in those cases where you have Orthodox priests, or people who have been ordained by Orthodox bishops, or even, let's say, the old Catholics from 1870 that split off from us, and those sorts of things, the Brazilian schismatic groups. I've seen all this over the years where this has happened. Well, in those cases, the Vatican weighs in, and my friend who did have valid orders was declined by the Vatican, and I have no idea the reason why. I'm sure he knows, but that's a private matter. But you have other cases where you have Anglicans who didn't even have valid orders, and they are discerned on the local level as having a calling, and you send them through formation. But in those cases, they go through formation, usually truncated, but they go through formation, and then they have to be ordained. So that can be handled on the local level by a bishop. There's no need to take that one up to the Vatican. But I guess, I hope I'm getting at what you are asking, but what I have found to be quite beautiful over the last, since 1988. How many years is that, real quick? 36?
Oh, good Lord.
What I have found over the last 36 years is that there is a huge amount of charity from the hierarchy in the Catholic Church when it comes to not just Protestants, but people of all, you know, Orthodox and even, you know, groups that are not traditionally Christian. You know, there's a real respect, and each one is dealt with on an individual basis, usually at the local level, except for, like I mentioned, there are some cases where it has to go to the Vatican. But does that get at your question?
For the most part, I guess a little bit of follow-up would be, you know, why would God put that into, you know, in the Catholic viewpoint?
Sure.
Call someone to Protestant ministry.
Right. Well, it that's a great mystery, right? That's like the fellow who asked the Holy Father about all the other world religions, right? Why does God all that gets into the great mystery of God's antecedent will and his consequent will. That's a simple philosophical out, right? You know, I mean, God's antecedent will is for everybody in the world to be Catholic, right? God wants everybody to experience our Blessed Lord in the Most Blessed Sacrament and the fullness of truth that we alone possess as Catholics. But there's God's consequent will as a result of the fall and sin and the complications that happen as a result of that. And this is why we can't judge on these matters down to the minutia, because God alone is the one who knows the beginning from the end, the end from the beginning, and everything in between. And so, yeah, God is moving in ways. I will tell you, brother, when I was Protestant, if anybody is going to tell me that the Holy Spirit was not moving, and when I used to preach as a Protestant minister, and when I saw people's lives changed, I saw people, you know, I've told this story on this broadcast before, Si, where a young man came to Christ. Well, you know what? Tell you what, we got to take a break. Let me just put a bow on this when we come back.
Hang on, you're going to get a bow in just a minute. Tim Staples, our guest. It's open forum, 888-318-7884.
Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, bulk cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or visit whywearecatholic.com.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
Welcome to a journey of faith, wisdom, and understanding. I'm Deacon Harold Burke-Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Si Kellett.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Si Kellett, your host. Tim Staples, our guest. Justin on the phone from Arkansas with a question about, you know, a person lives their life having, at least having believed that they were called to, say, be an Assemblies of God minister. How could God call someone to be a Protestant minister?
Yes. And, you know, we were talking a little bit over the break. It's such a good question, important question, and it's very involved. But, you know, it may well be, you know, when I used my own, right before we went off the air, I used my own experience as a former Assembly of God youth minister, and I was involved in various apostolic works as a Protestant over the years. And I said, you know, nobody's going to tell me the Holy Spirit didn't actually move. I mentioned that I had a dear friend in Marine Corps that I led to Christ, and he had gotten his girlfriend pregnant before he came to Christ, didn't even know it until after he had just given his life to Christ. And then he finds out his girlfriend, who was Catholic but not living her faith, was pregnant. And she wanted to have an abortion, and they wanted to keep it quiet. Did I ever tell you this story?
No. No.
And so he comes to me. I just led him to Christ, right? And this guy was the wildest guy in the barracks. He used to call him Rad, short for radical. And so he comes to me and says, Tim, is it okay if we have an abortion? You know, we want to keep it quiet. And I go, no, dude, no. So, you know, I get out Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 1, and Psalm 139, fearfully and wonderfully made, and no, thou shalt not kill. So I, but he was a very humble guy. And he said, you know what, Tim? If it's a baby, she ain't going to have an abortion. And he called her up on the phone and said, guess what? You're not having the abortion. She said, yes, I am. You don't have to carry this thing in you for 9 months. I do. He threatened to go to her Catholic parents.
Oh, no.
And now, I am not recommending this, folks. I am not. But he said, he called her and said, I will chain you to your house, your bed, whatever it takes. You are not going to the... She had scheduled the abortion. I will chain you in your house. I mean, it was gearing up to be a police involved situation. And I'm like, well, anyway, what happened? He basically forced her not to have that abortion. And I got orders right at that time when all this is happening. I got orders. One of these, any of you in the Marine Corps, in the military, you know, it was one of those. I got orders. I was gone like within a week. It was one of those, pack your bags, you're going to Quantico, Virginia. And I left El Toro and went to Quantico, Virginia. But months later, about 7-8 months later, I got a letter from her.
Oh, really?
Yes. And it was a picture of the new baby.
Aww.
And my buddy holding his new baby. And they got married. But holding that new baby. And it was a thank you to me. And she said, Tim, I just, because she hated me, bro. I mean, she didn't even want to look at me because I was the source of all this.
Yeah.
She despised me until that baby was born. Yeah. And then she wrote me, I've got goosebumps right now. We still have the letter at home. She, it was basically a thank you. And I just went, I don't want to say his name, but just to let you know that little Timothy is doing just fine. So they named the baby after me and the father. So it was Timothy. But anyway, here's the point. I mean, it was such a grace, the power of God, the Holy Spirit moving and such. You can't tell me that Protestant ministry and people, even of other world religions, God is at work, folks. Now, that doesn't mean everything that attempts to be passed as spirituality is. No. Some things that I believe that I did as a Pentecostal was a lot of emotion and not from the Holy Spirit. But you know what? I'm not even the judge, ultimately, mm-hmm. of what is real and what isn't. You know, except for the cases like where the church judges on matters like of apparitions and whatnot, these are things, Si, where we don't get a definitive No. word bolt from the blue. And so we in the Catholic Church understand this and understand that, yeah, the Holy Spirit does work. Now, it may well be that somebody like my brother Terry, who felt called to Protestant apostolic labor and such, ultimately, that calling that he had was to the priesthood.
Yeah.
And how do I know that? Well, because he's a priest. He's a priest today. I mean, but that doesn't mean, Cy Kellett, that somebody can't be called by God to be, let's say, a pastor in an Assembly of God community like I was, and God wanted me right there to reach this person, and within his complex, right? We talked about his consequent will, consequent to all the factors. Yes, God is blessing you right there. But ultimately, my friends, ultimately, God's antecedent will is for everybody to be Catholic, and that's what we have to work for.
Thank you very much for the call. I'm going to continue on, Justin, to try to get everybody on here with Tim, if I can. Mary is in West Virginia. Am I on the right one? Yeah, Mary's in West Virginia. Okay, Mary, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Yes, in the Catechism, in the section Fecundity of Marriage, paragraph 2372. Yes. I'm going to read the first two sentences here because I'd like an explanation.
Yes.
The state has a responsibility for its citizens' well-being. In this capacity, it is legitimate for it to intervene to orient the demography of the population.
Right.
What are they talking about?
Right. Yes. Governments are what they're talking about in a nutshell is what St. Paul talks about in Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 6, that God has instituted governments by his authority for the well-being of the citizenry of the various nations that he... And this is, you know, we were talking about the mystery of God's will working in the world. This is one of these examples, because you think about... When St. Paul is talking about that in Romans 13, 1 through 6, he's talking about a very corrupt Roman Empire. And he quotes the words of our blessed Lord, who was also talking about a very corrupt Roman Empire, when he said, "Render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and render unto God that which is God's." So render unto Caesar means that Caesar has legitimate authority, and one of those is regulating the demographics. For example, if you have a situation, India is a classic example. I have been there, and you have a situation where you have such overpopulation and poverty in certain areas where people are literally starving to death in the streets. The government has not only the right, but the duty to intervene in cases like that, in order to ensure that you can get clean water, separate populations if necessary, get people. And that is a huge task. And I think in order to fulfill that task, it has to be a joint venture. And this is going beyond what the Catechism section 2372 is talking about, but you will find that elsewhere in, you know, the examples of charity. And one of the essential missions of the Catholic Church is exactly to work together with governments in order to help these things come to fruition. So it does need to be, especially in our modern era, perhaps more than ever, when we're talking about the mega amounts of money involved, for governments to work together with the church, Cy, and with charitable organizations in order to make this happen in these cases, like I think the Catechism is talking about here in section 2372. Now, I have to say that, you know, some are cringing right now and saying, wait a minute, I don't want the government involved in any of this. And I sympathize with that, because you look at the government of the United States, India, like I said, I've been there, and the level of corruption in that government makes ours look like an honest government. And our government is incredibly corrupt and does, it's mastered the art of wasting billions of dollars. I mean, they have mastered it as an art of kickbacks and lining pockets of the right constituency and all of the rest of that. But none of that changes the reality that government still has an obligation, and it has an obligation to provide for the well-being, in particular the protection of its citizens, but also in these extreme cases of controlling demographics as well. Does that help at all?
Well, I get why, you know, the government has responsibility for things like you mentioned. I'm just confused by the phrase orient the demography of the population, because
sure,
this is the section talking about, you know, having children, and
yes.
So it just felt like the government's supposed to be involved in,
yes,
in how many kids people have.
Okay, or, no, now that's not what it says, right? Because notice, yeah, the next sentence, and you make a very good and important point. The next sentence: this can be done by means of objective and respectful information, but certainly not by authoritarian coercive measures, right? So how is a government supposed to do this? Well, ultimately, if we had Christian kings, it would be working together with the Pope, right? And respecting the moral law in the process, right? The problem comes in where you have atheistic governments like we do now, and it becomes very, very difficult to work in that context. But no, we're not talking about China, you know, telling people you can only have one child or now two and in some areas three or that sort of thing. No, that would be condemned in that next sentence by by the words authoritarian and coercion. See, it never fails whenever we get in these discussions, especially being in the United States, because we are so politicized here and I guess understandably so, that whenever you start talking about the role of the government, like let's take Christa Fidelis Laici of Pope St. John Paul the Great, section 38, the famous text. You couple that with Gaudium et Spes, section 26, that talks about the rights that human beings have just because they are human beings, right? Right to education, right to health care. Right, a right to have a roof over their head, a right to food, a right to water. All of these things are rights. And the church thunders that and has for 2,000 years, not because that the government says, okay, we've got a little leftover here, so we'll give you some food. No, they have a right to these things because they are human beings. But now, some will say, well, if you say that, and if you remember, if you're as old as I am, you remember John Paul was taken to task for those sorts of things. Well, you're advocating for socialism. No, he's not. He's simply stating the facts. How to get these things to the people when it comes to demographics and so forth, it cannot come by coercive and authoritative means, because what happens is a greater corruption where you have governments that become like North Korea, that become like China, where they're killing people in the name of making their lives better.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
They will kill you and think they're doing God's business, says our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So our most powerful weapon we have as Catholics is the gospel of Jesus Christ that challenges people. You've probably heard me say this, because I say it from time to time, and I've had people get mad at me for saying it. I will go after billionaires in the United States or I'll pick on the Walton family, all right? And I know, and I'm not talking about the television show.
You know, don't pick on them.
That's right.
You're talking about the Walmart.
The Walmart. And God bless them. I don't know them personally, but when you look at that family and the fact they're the wealthiest people in the world, they have way more money than Bezos, way more money than Elon Musk, but they split it up between the family.
Yeah.
They're worth like $300 billion or something like that. And yet, just recently, for the first time in 10 years, they gave a raise to their management here in the United States.
Oh.
And I just read the article, and it's like, am I supposed to pat you on the back? Because I know of people that worked for that company for years, and they could barely make ends meet as managers and such. That's wrong. I'm sorry, Cy. That's wrong. But you don't know their business model. You're right. I don't. And neither does the church when the church makes statements like this. What the church does is challenge people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know what? Do you really need $300 billion when you have folks over? Could you maybe lose $100 billion?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Could you? I mean,
and still squeak by?
And still squeak by.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you could give every manager in your company the ability to even raise a family. Most of those people can't have large families because they don't make enough money and they're struggling and so forth. That's what we're talking about here. And I think this is from the church's perspective. What the church does is not argue for authoritarian governments. No, that is wrong. The church has, in fact, formally condemned communism as contrary to the gospel of Jesus Christ. But there's also a problem with laissez-faire capitalism. Capitalism as a system, I don't have a problem with until it starts getting on the wrong side of John Paul, when Pope John Paul says, you know, people over profits. When you start emphasizing profit to the point where people don't matter anymore and people get crushed, That's when it gets out of line. And so whenever you read a section of the Catechism like 2372 that talks about government's responsibility, it always has to be understood in the context of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Government's role is to encourage, for example, and our government has had a good history in this respect in the past, of encouraging large families by giving tax breaks for each child. That is a good thing, and there are people in our government that want to take that away from us, right? But that's a good thing. That's a way a government can, not through coercion, but by encouragement, say, you know what, if you have more children in marriage, right, and we can, you know, stipulate these things, we're gonna encourage that by giving you tax breaks and such. Then if you have a situation where you have a group of people that's taking advantage of the poor and they're stacking them up in buildings where they don't even have proper running water and so forth, and yet they're demanding rent from these people and they're making money off of them, the government can step in situations like that and say, you know what, this isn't going to fly here, and there are various ways to do it. So it's a complex question, but I think hopefully that'll help you get started on it anyway.
Thanks, Mary. Thanks very much. We've got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum with Tim Staples on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the biggest mistakes a Christian can make is to try to do good without God's help. Saint Therese said, when we trust only ourselves and not God, our soul becomes incapable of virtue. Her remedy? Works of charity. And the greatest work of charity is to share the gospel. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we encourage you to share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
Carry the faith wherever you go. Watch the EWTN series, specials, events, and news streaming live from anywhere in the world. Streaming is available on the EWTN app for Apple, Android, and Amazon devices. Download the EWTN app at EWTNapps.com today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tim Staples, our guest. And it's Open Forum. Next hour, Carla Broussard will be here, and we will continue with our Open Forum. And Sid is in Lubbock, Texas, watching on YouTube. Sid, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Hey, thank you, guys. Thank you for Catholic Answers. Tim, yes. I can't go out. I can't turn on the TV or the radio without hearing our separated brethren talking about the rapture.
Yes.
So, my question is this. Did Augustine, Aquinas, church fathers, did they just totally miss the rapture? Or can you comment about that?
Sure, okay. Sure. It's a great question. Again, you've come to the right guy, because I used to preach the rapture when I was an Assembly of God youth minister. Oh, my goodness. I was raised on the rapture in the Southern Baptist community that I was born into. And so, yeah, I get it. But no, the rapture was basically created by a congregational minister by the name of John Darby, and I forget his middle name, but it was Darby. In fact, sometimes it's called Darbyism, right? But it's a
Nelson.
That's it. Yeah. Is it John Nelson Darby? Thank you, Cy Kellett. He was a congregational minister that kind of created the thing. And I know there are some who look back to a few lines here and there before that time, but he was really the one who created it. And then it took off. And a little bit later, 20, 30 years later, a fellow by the name of Schofield wrote his Schofield Study Bible, which became enormous. And that really put the rapture theory And it's called dispensationalism, which is the overall theological sort of infrastructure for this thing. And then into the 50s, 60s, 70s with the rapture craze that I was born into. But here's the bottom line. No, it was never taught by any Christian for the first 1800 years of the Christian era. It's basically a false teaching. But here's the key. What we believe is in the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The rapture theorists posit not just one coming of the Lord, but in a certain sense, you could say as many as four, depending upon how you look at it. Now, what do I mean by that? Because they take verses of scripture like what I used to do, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. Now the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the trump of God, the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ will be raised first, and then we who are alive and well will be caught up together with them in the air to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And they will dovetail that right into 1 Corinthians 15:51, where St. Paul talks about in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, this mortal body will put on immortality in a twinkling of an eye, right? So they put those two together and say, see, that's the rapture. No, that's not the rapture. That's the second coming. Both of those texts and others we could talk about, like Luke 17:31-34, there will be two in the bed, one will be taken, the other left behind. That's the famous text. It's also found in Matthew 24. In fact, they prefer the Matthew 24. They usually use that. But you know, the famous Tim LaHaye Left Behind series and that sort of thing, which became really popular a few years back. But there's two in the field, one's taken, the other is left behind, right? The theory is that there's coming this day when all of a sudden, all true believers in Jesus Christ, all those who are truly born again, will disappear. I can remember arguments saying, will your clothes be left behind or will you take your clothes with you? You know, and most would say you'll disappear right from underneath your clothes. Your clothes will drop down to the ground. And
well, then you're going
to
show up. And then
you're going to show up.
That's embarrassing.
You mean you won't show up naked? Naked? Well, anyway, but, you know, people will be driving in cars and the cars will crash because the driver was a Christian. Airplanes will crash and all of this, right? Well, none of that is taught in the Bible, my friend. That's not in 1 Thessalonians 4. That's not. In fact, in Luke 17, if you read the whole context of verses 31 through 34 and 35, you'll see that the ones that are being taken are being taken to judgment. Because he says, where the corpses are, they're the vultures, or some say eagles. It's a scavenger bird there. The vultures will be gathered. So where the body is, the vultures will be gathered. This is not talking about some rapture where people disagree. This is talking about two separate things. In Luke chapter 17, it's talking about first and foremost a judgment that was about to fall on Israel that happened, and Jesus described it in Matthew chapter 24, the first few verses, where the temple would be obliterated and judgment would fall. And literally, we know from Josephus's history as one who was there that it was an incredibly bloody and brutal crushing of the Jewish people and the destruction of the temple by Titus and the Roman legions that came through in fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy 40 years earlier, and it happened in 70 AD. That's the first meaning there of Luke 17. But by allusion, it's also referring to the second coming at the end of time, the final consummation of all things. And that's what 1 Thessalonians 4 and 1 Corinthians 15 are talking about, the second coming, which is a mystery beyond anything we can fathom, where the consummation of all things happens at the very end of time. The rapture theorists say, are you kidding? After that comes wars and death and all sorts of things. No, no, no. That's the end of time, the second coming of our blessed Lord.
And we've reached the end of time. At
that
least for
can't
this
be.
Hour.
No!
We've reached the end of this
we
hour.
We just got started.
Carla Broussard will be here. So, hey, if you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't called yet, 888-318-7884. We continue with Open Forum. And I want to stress again, open to anybody. You don't have to be Catholic. You don't have to be Christian to call. If you got a question about Christianity, question about Catholicism, give us a call. 888-318-7884. Thanks, Tim.
All right, brother.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As promised, Carlo Broussard here with us for this hour of Open Forum. One line open right now. So if you're thinking you wanted to call, but all the lines were full, 888-318-7884 is the number. Go ahead and take advantage of that. 888-318-7884. Carlo, he's in Tulsa. He splits his life in a certain way. He's one of us, 100% Catholic Answers, but he does lots of his time is spent working with the folks in the Diocese of Tulsa and Eastern Oklahoma. And also he's finishing his doctorate. He's written a whole bunch of books. He's also just Carlo, just all around great guy. Carlo Broussard, thanks for being here for this hour.
Hey, Si, thanks for having me, man. It's always great to be with you, and got some big shoes to fill following up old Tim Staples there.
I know you do, and we'll be monitoring to see how you do. We'll be monitoring your performance this hour. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. You can ask whatever you'd like to ask about the Catholic faith. And Carlo, you were 95% under the shadow of the moon yesterday. And it was weird.
Yes, I was, man.
Was it weird?
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. Yeah, it was awesome to experience it. I was blessed in my schedule to be able to be home with my wife and kids, and we were outside spending time watching it and experiencing it, and so it was great. We enjoyed it. Yeah, it was fun.
Well, 20 more years, there'll be another one here in the U.S. It'll come by.
There you go.
Just hang out 20 more years. Although I think they actually happen quite often. Like, it's not that rare. If somewhere in the world there's one, but I would imagine most of those are just over water and you'd probably have to be on a boat or a plane to experience it. But from what Jimmy Akin said to me about it, I asked him about it because he drove over to a town where it was 100% near him. And
awesome.
And I'd like to see it. It sounds like something worth seeing. So I'll be a little more proactive next time.
It was cool.
888-318-7884 is the number. Carlo is also here to help you with your Sunday readings. He's got a podcast, Sunday Catholic Word, and you can find it at, tell us, I'll just let you, because I have messed it up so many times, Carlo, and I don't want to mess it up anymore. So I'm going to let you. Where do they find it? What does it do?
Yeah, so the Sunday Catholic Word is my podcast for Catholic Answers, where I look at the upcoming Sunday Mass readings and highlight those details that are relevant for explaining and defending the Catholic faith or for doing apologetics. So there are many podcasts out there, but we kind of give it a little Catholic Answers flavor and highlight those apologetical details. So if you ever wondered, what does the mind of an apologist latch onto as he's sitting in the pew listening to the Liturgy of the Word? Listen to the podcast. And so I highlight those details. And basically, I explain how the certain details come up in conversations with our Protestant friends or with skeptics, whether it's being presented as positive evidence for a Catholic belief, or if it's a passage that our Protestant friends might appeal to and say, hey, your belief contradicts that passage, or mm-hmm. a skeptic might appeal to and say, hey, that passage is false there, it's not historically reliable. Those are the types of details that I'm highlighting, and whatever details that are relevant for good, deep theological reflection that often comes up in conversations. And so people are enjoying it, and they can subscribe at SundayCatholicWord.com. And for this upcoming Sunday Catholic Word, I'll be looking at the readings for the third Sunday of Easter. I'll be focusing on four details, the first two coming from the first reading taken from Acts 3, 13 through 15 and 17 through 19, and the relevant topics there that come to the fore is the early church's belief about Christ's divinity and the church's teaching on invincible ignorance when it comes to sin. And then the remaining details come from the gospel taken from Luke 24, 35 through 48. And there are two apologetical topics that come into play there, the bodily nature of Jesus' resurrection and its significance for countering alternative explanations to Christ's literal resurrection, and the Catholic appeal to John 20:23 as biblical support for the sacrament of reconciliation. There's a famous Protestant objection that comes from the passage for the gospel reading that's appealed to in order to undermine our sacramental interpretation of the famous text in John 20:23. So again, that's SundayCatholicWord.com or MrSundayPodcast.com. And that's where they can get a hold to the podcast.
Check it out, Sunday Catholic Word. And he's going to, so far we're into, well, we're like a third of the way into year B. So,
yes.
Yeah, you've got still more, a good deal more ahead of you before you've hit the full 3-year cycle.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to go, that's right, we're going to go through all 3 years and go through year C and complete it. And who knows, maybe at the end, if Todd Aglialoro is listening, perhaps we might have a book, maybe something like Apologetics for Homiletics. Who knows? Just saying.
I think you use your time on the air to make a pitch to Todd, who I have a feeling doesn't listen to the show. I don't know for sure. But I think he's down there under piles of manuscripts editing. But if you're listening, Todd, there's another book idea for you. 888-318-7884 is our number here. Carlo Broussard, our guest. It's open forum, and we're going to Jeff in Memphis, Tennessee, watching on YouTube. Jeff, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Carlo.
Hey, how y'all doing?
Very well. Thank you.
Good. So I was telling a guy, I'm a certified ordained minister, an almost certified candidate for ordained ministry in the United Methodist Church. I'm a recovering Southern Baptist, and I recently graduated from seminary.
Okay.
And during seminary, in one of my liturgy courses, I really started falling in love with the liturgy, really started falling in love with the way the scripture unfolds through it and all that good stuff. And then
yeah.
I'm sitting at a restaurant one night. I meet John Edwards from Just a Guy in the Pew podcast, and we start talking about the Catholic Church and mission. And next thing I know, over the last 2 weeks, I've read Rome Sweet Home, Jesus and the Jewish Roots of the Eucharist, and I've bought your book, Meeting the Protestant Response.
Oh,
and
thank you.
One of Tim's books. And I'm in this journey, and I'm trying. The problem is, I'm called to ministry, and I know there was a caller earlier, Justin, I believe, from Arkansas.
Yeah, very fitting, and, right?
Yeah, and I'm called to ministry. I'm on this weird spiraling journey where I can't put the literature down. I can't stop reading, and I'm praying about it. It's constant.
Yeah.
And there's so much out there. I got overwhelmed at the bookstore. I don't even know what else, like what I need to be doing, but. I just feel like I should be continued down this path.
But okay.
I don't. My question is just, you know, as a Protestant.
Yeah.
Do I keep exploring?
Well, I know the answer to that one.
Yeah. Well, first of all, Jeff, thank you very much, brother, for giving us a call and chatting with us and sharing your heart and sharing your journey. We really appreciate that, man. And so the answer to that short question is yes, keep exploring. Because as you know and I know, we love our Lord, we want the truth, and we need to be honest in pursuing the truth. And if the Lord is providing for us lights upon the path, keep following the path. The second thought that comes to mind, Jeff, is, man, I just had a lunch with a friend of mine, a recent friend, just met him a couple of weeks ago, a Presbyterian pastor who is basically choosing to become Catholic. Like he has been on a 3-year journey of intense study. He found himself in the same boat as you, Jeff, where he started studying and he felt the prompting of the Spirit within his heart and followed that path. And he's now at a point where he's having to make that crucial decision. And so I just share that with you to let you know you're not alone. And there are many right now who are experiencing the same thing that you're experiencing. And so if with regard to continuing the exploration, I would highly encourage you, Jeff, to visit our website at Catholic.com frequently. As you probably already know, we have tons of resources for free, video, audio, and articles. Now, as far as some resources, some books go, I would recommend, so you mentioned the liturgy and how the liturgy captured you. First of all, I would recommend attending good Catholic liturgy. And for my friend who is making this decision to become Catholic, he was expressing to me he was deeply moved by the experience of the Catholic liturgy and leading him to tears. And that's kind of what was sort of the nail in the coffin for him as to whether to become Catholic. And he, this individual, experienced that in the liturgy. So I would recommend that you get a hold to then Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger's book, Spirit of the Liturgy, where he gives a theological explanation of the liturgy. Very deep, very profound, and I promise you, Jeff, you'll enjoy it. There's also Dr. Scott Hans, and you're familiar with him in reading, I think you said Rome Sweet Home, right? Is that what you read?
Yes.
Correct, yeah.
So Dr. Hahn has the Lamb's Supper. I don't know if you've come across that yet. Similar stuff to Petrie's book, Jesus and the Jewish Roots of the Eucharist, but different because Dr. Hahn is providing a commentary on the celebration of the Mass in light of the Book of Revelation and showing the harmony between the heavenly liturgy and the earthly liturgy that we experience every Sunday when we go to Mass. And that Mass is inundated with scriptural references to the heavenly liturgy as revealed in the Book of Revelation. So those would be two resources that can at least begin your deep dive and reflection and study and meditation on the liturgy. Now, with regard to Catholicism in general, as to whether Catholicism is true and the historical evidence for Catholicism, etc., I would recommend two resources. Number one is just a simple introduction. Hey, it's an introduction, but it might be helpful for you, Jeff. And that's my colleague and good friend Trent Horn's book, Why We're Catholic. It's a great read for whether you're a scholar like yourself and studying in seminary or somebody who's just introduced to Catholicism. I would recommend that just to kind of get your feet wet. With regard to the papacy, because that's going to be the central issue for us as Catholics, and I would assume for you, Jeff, because it all comes down to authority, I would recommend Eric Ybarra's book, The Papacy Revisiting the Debate Between Catholics and Orthodox, and Ybarra is Y-B-A-R-R-A, I think, Eric with a K, Ybarra. So that would give you a deep dive, some scholarly resources for the papacy, and just follow the research trail, okay? Now, with regard to the second big issue that's probably going to arise for you, Jeff, as you're on this journey, is the issue of salvation. And for a good resource that articulates the Catholic understanding of salvation in light of how our Protestant brothers and sisters understand salvation and where the differences lie, where the similarities lie, I would recommend my colleague and good friend Jimmy Akin's book, The Drama of Salvation, which you can get at shop.catholic.com. So I think with that initial load of resources, Jeff, you can at least begin to read, follow the research trail in those resources. And brother, give us a call back, man. And you know what? I tell you what, Jeff, stay on the line and give the call screener your email address because I'd like to reach out to you and stay in touch with you and answer any possible questions that you have. And I can direct you to resources, et cetera. So thank you for calling, brother. Any thoughts in response?
No, that's amazing. I'm a big reader as a seminarian and, now I can actually read for fun, so it's nice. And this is what I've filled my fun reading with is Catholic beautiful books, and I think it's changing my life.
What a beautiful call, Jeff. I'll tell you what, two of the books that Carlo mentioned, I know I can just have sent to you. So when you give your email address to Edgar, if you give him a physical address, we'll send Why We're Catholic and The Drama of Salvation to wherever you are. But it would be great to hear from you again. I hope you'll call again, Jeff. Thank you.
Yes, thank you guys. Appreciate it.
All right. God bless you. We'll take a very quick break.
You too.
Right back with more Open Forum with Carlo Broussard on Catholic Answers Live.
Your questions, Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at magnificat.com.
Proclaiming the faith, changing lives.
The year was 1984. Mother Angelica Live is the only religious program nominated for an award for cable excellence Later in the year, she wins a Gabriel Personal Achievement Award from Catholic Broadcasters and Communicators.
To learn more about Mother Angelica's life and the history of EWTN, visit EWTN.com/Mother Angelica.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Hey, Catholic Answers is taking a cruise June 29th through July 6th. And we'd love it if you'd come. Joe Heschmeyer is going to be there. I'm going to be there. Chris Check's going to be there. We'll have a wonderful priest who you hear on the air here with us sometimes, Father Paul Jerome Keller, as our chaplain. And it's just scores of other Catholics. I think we're coming up on 150 now. As a matter of fact, I've been promised that if we hit 150 people signed up, Chris Check is going to buy me a box of cookies. He apparently thinks that will motivate me to advertise this more. So he ain't wrong about that, let me tell you. So just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com, CatholicAnswersCruise.com. We're going to start in Montreal. We'll see Quebec. We'll visit St. Anne de Beaupré. We'll see Nova Scotia and a lot of other places on the way down to Boston, where we will arrive the morning of July 6th. We'd love it if you'd come. Just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com for all the information and to sign up. All right. First of all, what a lovely call that last call was to get somebody like Jeff to call. I don't have any audio on Carlo at the moment, so...
Hello?
Yeah, no, I got you now. But I saw you say yes.
All right,
and then
here.
I didn't hear anything come out. And I, so I knew there was something up. A couple of Protestant ministers today, or at least on their way to Protestant ministry. And, and I do think that, you know, he mentioned that he got your book, or else I would have given it to him, Meeting the Protestant Response. But I have to say, I love your style, Carlo, of dialogue, of conversation, of taking objections seriously. You don't ever have the attitude of there's a slam dunk Catholic argument. The Catholic arguments are true, but that doesn't mean that that we shouldn't have a deep, profound conversations that are respectful in order to unveil that truth, I guess.
Yeah, amen. Well, first of all, thank you for the kind words, Cy. And secondly, it's true, man. You know, we're all on a journey of knowledge, just like Jeff was explaining. You know, he pursuing ministry and Protestantism as a pastor, and then the Lord gives him these special actual graces, these helps of the mind and the heart, and pursuing that truth, and the Lord giving us those lights upon the path. And so for our Protestant brothers and sisters, you know, just sometimes they're just not at a place in the journey where they have been illumined in the mind with a Catholic articulation of certain issues of theology. And maybe they've heard popular expressions that sort of lack the nuances that are needed in order to persuade the Protestant to the conclusion, or just flat out receive false articulations, wrong articulations, misconceptions of what we believe as Catholics, and leading them unintentionally to false conclusions. And so, and finally, as I point out in my book, Meeting the Protestant Response, our Protestant brothers and sisters simply have, on the surface, good alternative explanations of the text that we traditionally appeal to in support of our beliefs, that without proper training in biblical exegesis in our Catholic tradition, I can understand how a Protestant would say, yeah, I think I'm justified in my Protestantism in face of these Catholic passages. But what I try to offer in my book, Meeting the Protestant Response, after I give a voice to Protestant apologists and their readings of these classic texts, say Matthew 16, 18 through 19, I explain why those Protestant alternative readings ultimately do not succeed in comparison to the Catholic understanding, thus allowing the Catholic to continue to appeal to those classic texts in support of our Catholic beliefs.
George is in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. George, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Carlo.
Hi, Carlo. Thank you for taking my question. Partially addressed in the previous hour when we were discussing Protestant callings from God. And my question is a little broader than that. With the Holy Spirit, clearly God can work through the Holy Spirit outside the visible confines of the Catholic Church. And my question is, you know, this really struggles. This is a struggle for me because a lot of times people may see, you know, answered prayers or other signs and miracles as maybe affirming of them either being not needing to come into the Catholic faith, or maybe affirming them they left and they don't need to come back now because they see this as like affirmation of their personal relationship. So my question is, could you just sort of expound more on that? And also, in the early Christian period, what were the church fathers and other church writers saying about contemporary heretical or schismatic groups and their spirituality in this respect?
All right. So with regard to the second question, I would have to do a little bit of research, George, and open up the books and look at the early church writings and fathers and what they're saying concerning the heretics and their standing before God. You know, I would suspect that what we would find is what the church teaches today concerning the possibility of invincible ignorance, that one, although objectively might be guilty of heresy and even obstinately opposed, the question still remains as to whether in their mind they are truly rejecting the truth, and that would be reserved to God alone, and judging whether one is actually making a positive act of the will to reject what he knows to be true. Maybe perhaps in the mind of the quote-unquote heretic, the individual has a false conception of the truth, and thereby rejecting something that wouldn't entail the guilt of mortal sin. So that's speculation on my part. Again, I'm going to bow in humility there and say I'm going to have to do some research on that second question. But with regard to your first question and the Holy Spirit working outside the visible confines of the church, but with regard to non-Catholic Christians having confirmations of their prayers and signs and miracles. So my first question would be, is this a case where a miracle or an answered prayer is being given specifically for, quote unquote, not coming into the Catholic faith? That would be my first question. So we would have to analyze it, assess it, think through it on an individual basis. I would contend that God is not going to give any sort of visible confirmation for that specific claim itself or that specific request. Like, God, should I not enter into the Catholic faith? I would contend God would not give a visible confirmation of that because of my presupposed belief that the Catholic Church is the true church of Jesus Christ. Can the Lord provide visible confirmations of that person's relationship with Christ, the name of Jesus, and confirmation for them in their decisions in life concerning what they should do, the people they should hang around with, and even a pastor that they should be listening to, right? So if you got a really horrible pastor and they're like, God, should I go to this other pastor who's teaching this other stuff? And for whatever truth that other pastor is teaching, I would contend the Holy Spirit could move that person to get away from the really, really bad stuff to go to a pastor who might not have the fullness of truth, but nevertheless is teaching more truth than the other pastor. So that would be a case where you could have visible confirmation of that in one's discernment. I would contend that visible confirmation will be given to confirm for the person their personal relationship with Jesus and the Spirit moving in their heart to intensify their relationship with Jesus, even outside the church. Not that the Holy Spirit would move them outside of the Holy Church, outside the Holy Catholic Church, but that they would get legitimate consolation from the Spirit of God when they are studying God's word, which just so happens to be in God's providence of his permission of them studying God's word outside the church, spiritual consolation and joy found in the reading of God's word. Now, notice in that hypothetical scenario, which is, I think, in a good case, the Holy Spirit would not be given a consolation for them leaving the Catholic Church or being outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, but rather giving them consolation that it is good to study God's word. It is good to reflect upon theological truths given to us from the word of God. So a Protestant and a Christian outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church is going to have that joy, experience the graces and the increase of grace that could come about from doing that good thing. Again, not a confirmation of being separated from the church, but a confirmation of the precise good that the non-Catholic Christian is pursuing and marveling in. And I would contend that if we lay out on the table the different individual circumstances and situations where you have visible confirmations of something, you're going to find a good that the Holy Spirit is confirming, not a confirmation of being separated from the church.
George, thanks. Brought us right to the break. We'll take that break and be right back. Lots more to come. Carla Broussard is our guest. It's Open Forum. Catholic Answers Live. Right back after this. When it comes to Catholic teachings about Mary, there's one question we hear more than any other. Where is that in the Bible? The answer? Everywhere. In Bible Mary, the Mother of Jesus and the Word of God, Father John Weiss opens Scripture to reveal a Mary who has been hiding in plain sight. Father Weiss discloses the new Eve foretold in the Old Testament and revealed in the New. Order your copy of Bible Mary today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Are you scared to talk about abortion? Don't worry, almost everyone is. You can overcome this fear as Trent Horn shows in the newly revised and expanded second edition of Persuasive Pro-Life. With a little knowledge and a few proven techniques, you can become a bold and effective apologist for life. Visit shop.catholic.com to order your copy of Persuasive Pro-Life and never again be afraid to speak up. Also available at good Catholic bookstores.
Is Orthodoxy an alternative to the Catholic Church? In a time of uncertainty for many Catholics, Orthodoxy can look like greener pastures. Answering Orthodoxy, the new book from Catholic Answers Press, explains why Catholics who are thinking of leaving need to think twice. There are important reasons to remain in the Catholic Church and convincing answers to Orthodox claims. Order your copy of Answering Orthodoxy today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome to a journey of faith, wisdom, and understanding. I'm Deacon Harold Burke-Sivers.
And I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. It is Open Forum. Carla Broussard is our guest. We're having a great time. And just to really bring things to a fever pitch, Thomas the TikTok Engine is here. Hello,
what's up,
Thomas
Ty?
The TikTok Engine.
How you doing?
Thomas comes in from where he lives, which is in TikTok. Is that where you live? Do you live in TikTok or do you have another house that you go to?
Some of the day I live in TikTok, it feels like. But
yeah, I'm sure it does feel like that.
I do live in a physical house as well.
Thomas is a very useful part of the show. You're very useful, Thomas.
A very useful what?
You're a very useful engine.
That's right. That's what I like to hear. The highest possible compliment in the Thomas the Tank Engine universe.
Oh, you're aware of that. I didn't know how aware you were going to be of that.
I needed to hear the engine part
because Darren and I were talking about it. It's hard if I discuss what we discussed earlier, Darren. We were discussing this, and that seems like the wrong lesson to teach children, that your value is in your usefulness.
A bit utilitarian.
We should ask Carlo that because he's a philosopher. Like you have value other than being useful, isn't that right, Carlo?
Amen. That's what the recent declaration of the church says in Dignitas Infinita.
Right.
You like how I put that in there?
Yeah, some people are like kind of useless in a certain way. They're like radio hosts. And if you just
absolutely.
Go around
absolutely.
And judge people by their usefulness, but you are useful.
Thomas. Well, I mean, and we're about to, my wife and I are about to welcome a baby into the world, and it's hard to think of something less useful in a certain sense than a baby. But I couldn't be more excited to have that little guy around, because there's a lot more to, you know, being a desirable human than being useful.
Well said. Amen. And when is that baby coming? Do we know?
He's due a week from yesterday.
Oh, he's due a week from yesterday. That seems like a
six
math
days.
Problem.
That's okay, a much days, easier way to say that. I don't know why I made it more
confusing.
Yeah,
that's much more useful, Thomas. Just tell me how many days. Yeah. I'm so excited that the baby's coming.
Me too.
Baby has a lovely mom, too, Mrs. TikTok Engines.
100% he does.
Lovely person. And all right, Thomas, make yourself useful.
Okay, here we go. And if anyone wants to see the answer to this question later on, it will be posted to our TikTok and Instagram and Twitter and Facebook feeds, as many as possible, basically. And you
are
can
you
find
dragging
those.
Out your time on the show right now? It feels like you're just
I'm
dragging.
Hamming it up a little,
okay.
You know.
All right, go ahead.
But if you want to see it, search for Catholic Answers. Search for Catholic Answers on any of those platforms, and this clip will be posted there. So, Carlo, the actual question. This person asks, what do Catholics believe about what's going to get them into heaven? I'm Catholic, but some say it's good works, but I keep saying it's through Jesus Christ.
Yeah, so notice the implication is that is Jesus Christ exclusive from good works. And so we would respond to that, first of all, and say, well, the simple answer to the question as to what's going to get us into heaven is dying in friendship with Jesus Christ, which is rooted in and constituted by having sanctifying grace, that abiding, habitual quality of the soul that God puts in us that makes us be in a right relationship with God. So the question then becomes, when and how do we get that sanctifying grace that puts us into friendship with God? Well, according to the Bible, initially we get it through baptism. 1 Peter 3:1, baptism now saves you. Romans 6:3 through 4, we die with Christ in baptism, we rise to newness of life, and then in verse 7, we are freed from sin. The Greek word there literally translates justified from sin. So initially we get that grace which puts us in a friendly relationship with God, or as Romans 5:1 says, at peace with God through baptism. Romans 5:5, the love of God is poured within our heart. That's what puts us at peace with God. Now the question becomes, well, how do we preserve that friendship with God, which we have in virtue of sanctifying grace? And here's where good works come into play, Thomas. Good works are performed, that is, works animated by the theological virtue of charity, which is, according to Philippians 2:13, God working in and through us to accomplish the good works. So these good works that are ordered toward preserving this sanctifying grace or friendship with Christ is our works that are performed in and through us by our free wills, absolutely, but ultimately and also by God working through us in a supernatural way by his grace, we call sanctifying grace, and with its theological virtue of charity, in order to preserve that friendship. And here's the final point, Thomas. We receive finally the eternal reward of eternal life itself, quote unquote, entrance into heaven, on account of those works animated by charity. In other words, on account of those works of love. So dying in friendship with Christ is key, and works have a role to play with that, because works of love preserve that friendship, which is given to us by sanctifying grace with God, and increase that friendship with God. And so this is why Jesus will say in Matthew 25:31 through 46, the sheep enter into eternal life on account of the works of love that they performed, and the goats go into eternal damnation on account of not performing the works of love. So works do play a role with regard to us entering into heaven, but only after we're already initially saved by God's grace, which is given to us as a free gift, instrumentally and initially and ordinarily through baptism. So that's how I would answer that question. So notice, and finally, the last point, I'm sorry, I almost forgot this. Notice how everything I've said so far is not mutually exclusive from Jesus, because our salvation is applied to us from the source, Jesus Christ, and whatever charity is infused within our soul through sanctifying grace is given to us by Christ, because of Christ, and whatever works that we perform that contribute to us receiving the reward of heaven at the end of our lives at judgment, it's because of Christ working in and through us. So as St. Augustine would say, God crowns his own works. And that is to say we receive eternal life on account of the works of love that we do in and through Jesus Christ. So it's not Jesus or works, it's Jesus and works, because it's works done in and through and with Jesus.
It all flows from him as the beginning, right? As the first source of it all.
Not only flowing from him as the source, as if we get it from him and then thereby he's no longer involved and we're just doing it on our own. That would be actually heretical from the Catholic theological viewpoint. It's not only that we're receiving the power from Jesus as a source, but at every moment I'm performing some work that contributes to my salvation animated by charity, it's because of Jesus Christ at every moment. So notice there's one effect, the good work, that's coming from two principles, two agents, me and Jesus. And so that good work, whatever work of love I do, like the sheep in Matthew 25, those good works are the result of not only the individuals performing the works, but Jesus Christ himself. Because Philippians 2:13 tells us it's God who works in and through us when we accomplish those good works.
Very thorough, Carlo. Thank you.
Thank you, Thomas, the heretical TikTok engine. Appreciate you coming.
I'm just going to say, take it or leave it. I'm just going to say that was a test. We'll just say I was testing Carlo and passed with flying colors.
Well,
definitely not falling into material heresy. Right
now. I'll give you a pass on that, Thomas, because when you said the source can be ambiguous. Source can mean coming from and no longer applied, or source can be at whatever moment I'm performing that good work is coming from Jesus Christ, the source of that good work. So you were correct and understood in that way.
And like a true Thomist, you distinguished very precisely.
Yep. And not only that, Thomas, you were useful. Thank you for being useful, Thomas, the TikTok engine.
Thank
you very much, Thomas. Andrew's in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Andrew, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Carlo.
Thank you. I've been invited to my cousin's wedding. I'm trying to make a difficult choice of whether or not to attend. I've researched on Catholic.com to make my decision. I want to clarify what I've read with you guys.
Okay.
I have not gotten all the information from my cousin yet, but what I do know, at least on my cousin's part, with whom I'm not close, is that they had not been married or divorced before. Also, they should for sure be married in the Catholic Church if they are still Catholic. And here are the questions. If they got a dispensation from a priest to get married outside of a church, can I attend? If they have renounced their faith as a Catholic and no longer recognizes the church's authority and go with some other form of minister to marry them, could I attend?
I got two scenarios here. All right. You got a third one, or are you ready to rock and roll?
I suppose the third one was all-encompassing, was why are Catholics obligated to get married in the church?
Okay. All right. So with regard to the first scenario, I'm assuming you mean getting married outside a physical church building, like getting married outside with special permission. But nevertheless, they would be getting married, quote unquote, in the church. So assuming here that they have an official witness of the Catholic Church, whether bishop, priest, deacon, or some layperson appointed by the bishop to officially witness that church. If that's the scenario, Andrew, that you're talking about, so it's outside a physical church building, but it's in the church in the sense that it's recognized by the Catholic Church, sure, you would be absolutely able to attend that wedding. Again, assuming that they have an official witness of the Catholic Church and they're getting married in the church in that sense. Now, the second scenario that you propose, they reject the Catholic Church, they go and get married by someone other than, or they do not have an official witness of the Catholic Church. Andrew, unfortunately, the church has not given us any sort of clarity on this particular issue. So I cannot bind your conscience on account of the authority of the church. But what I can do is offer you my personal opinion, and I cannot come to any peace of mind in my own moral philosophical reasoning as to, in this sort of circumstance, to be justified in being a visible witness, not in an official sense, but just visibly being there witnessing the ceremony. I cannot justify in any place in my heart and mind to do that, precisely because of my knowledge, knowing that it's an invalid marriage, and the nature of my presence there visibly testifies an approval of what is happening and a celebration of what is happening. And in my own moral reasoning, that seems to me to be bearing a false witness, to where the what is visibly being testified is not mapping on and consistent with what I know and what I actually intend with my heart and with my mind. And so personally, I cannot recommend anyone to attend this an invalid union in this particular circumstance. Now, with regard to the third question of why are we obligated as Catholics to be married by to have an official witness of the church, to officially recognize the Catholic Church? Well, I think the bottom line answer here, Andrew, is that Christ entrusted to the church the authority, the privilege, the duty, and the service of governing the sacraments. So the sacraments have been given to us by Christ, and he entrusts that into Holy Mother Church's care. And Holy Mother Church, in virtue of the authority to bind and loose on earth and it be bound and loosed in heaven, has a judicial authority, a governing authority to govern the use of the sacraments. And so Holy Mother Church is going to impose upon her children and say, hey, you need to have an official witness of the church so that to signify visibly that the church has rightful authority to look out for and govern these great sacred mysteries and gifts that Christ has given to us, such that they're not just haphazardly to be used, but they are to be used in accord with Christ's will and how Christ wills for us to use these great gifts in union with the church that he established. And so it's a visible testimony of our union with the church and how these sacraments or gifts entrusted to the church's care, and it belongs to Holy Mother Church to care for those sacraments and, of course, to make certain disciplinary precepts as to how to govern those sacraments. And so those are a few initial thoughts. That third question is something I've never really considered before, so it was a good question. I appreciate it. And so those are at least some initial thoughts as how I would begin to sketch out a possible answer to that. Any thoughts, Andrew?
I learned something from you. I had thought that it was always that Catholics were always supposed to be married inside a Catholic church instead of as long as a Catholic priest is there to minister it.
Yeah, a Catholic is permitted, as you said, you know, with a special permission to be validly married outside the physical building of a church. But there must, in order for it to be a valid marriage, assuming that both parties are Catholics, or at least one party is a Catholic, that there would have to be an official witness of the church. And as I said, bishop, priest, deacon, or even a lay person appointed by the bishop to be an official witness.
I got to take the break. Andrew, thank you very much for the call. It's Open Forum. Carlo Broussard, our guest, right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
In Morse code, the sequence SOS is a distress call. It's been said that it stands for Save Our Souls. Well, right now our world is in big trouble, and we're putting out an SOS call for help. Will you answer that call? St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, has hundreds of teams who share the good news with souls who don't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to get involved.
Wherever you are in the world, you can access the EWTN Global Catholic Network. It's everywhere. You can get EWTN's great Catholic programming on your car radio, at home on your TV, computer, or smart speaker. With EWTN's app, you can take EWTN everywhere, on your phone or mobile device. If you want your news in print, turn to EWTN's paper of record, the National Catholic Register. EWTN, the Global Catholic Network.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live.
I am Cy Kellett, your host. Carlo Broussard is our guest. Check out his work at SundayCatholicWord.com. Sunday Catholic Word is his podcast, helping you to look at the readings or consider the readings for Sunday in light of how the readings might relate to Catholic apologetics and what apologists do. Check it out at SundayCatholicWord.com. Zachary's in New York City. New York City! Listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Welcome, Zachary. Go ahead with your question for Carlo.
Hey, thank you very much. I have been reading a book about the different theories of atonement within the, you know, the Christian world. And it claims that, or the author claims that the Catholic doctrine of atonement has changed from the idea that the sacrifice of Jesus was to appease God's justice. And they said that was said in the Council of Trent and before that. And then now, post-Vatican II, it has changed to an idea of more of like a reconciliation of us to God as the central theme. And this author claims that it kind of shows that the Catholic Church is indecisive on some major issues concerning salvation. So is there any truth to this, and does it create doctrinal issues?
All right, great question, Zachary. First of all, I'm going to recommend an episode of my colleague and good friend Joe Heschmeyer's podcast, Shameless Popery. If you go to Catholic.com and just type in the search engine, Joe Heschmeyer, Penal Substitution, he has a great episode where he articulates the Catholic view of the atonement in light of penal substitution theory and contrasting the two views of the Catholic view of vicarious satisfaction and penal substitution theory. I would also recommend Jimmy Akin's book, The Drama of Salvation. You can get that at shop.catholic.com. So it's difficult to speak directly to the argument that's being made without any sort of citations in front of us to study and to go through. But generally speaking, I'm going to say, Zachary, that there is no contradiction between the two. There is no problem between the two points that you just articulated. One, the appeasement of God's justice, and two, reconciliation, because both are true and both are compatible. So with regard to the appeasement of God's justice, that is to be understood in light of the biblical teaching that Christ's death on the cross was pleasing to God. And on account of that death, the debt that was due to the human race is indeed remitted. God the Father willed to remit the debt of the human race in Adam's sin through the death of Jesus Christ. So on account of the death of Jesus Christ, that debt of sin is remitted, and thereby God's justice is satisfied. But notice, Zachary, that in that articulation, there is no logical need for punishment to be inserted within that view and that framework. Merely affirming that Jesus' death on the cross was that on account of which the debt of the human race was remitted, that doesn't mean that the Father was, quote-unquote, punishing Jesus through his death on the cross. That would be penal substitution theory. That is what we would reject and deny as Catholics. Rather, in this theological framework, we have what is called vicarious satisfaction, where Christ does compensate for our sin by offering himself on the cross. But that compensation, because it's moved by love and because Jesus is innocent and has no sin, it's satisfaction without any sin on his part involved. It is satisfaction for our sin and thus remitting the debt of the punishment. But that doesn't mean the Father is punishing Jesus. Now, here's how the second part, emphasized by the Second Vatican Council, relates to that. On account of that vicarious satisfaction of Christ on the cross, on account of Jesus' death on the cross, which remits the debt of punishment due to the human race is thereby reconciled back to God. And so there is no theological necessity for this sort of theological framework of vicarious satisfaction to involve punishment, God punishing, because Christ exercising charity can compensate for our offense simply in virtue of that charity in order that the Father would no longer hold the human race accountable on account of Jesus' death on the cross. What do you think of that, brother?
No, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. The only question I have is, has penal substitution always been rejected by the church?
Yeah, so, you know, with regard to that, when you say always been rejected by the church, I'm not going to be able to give a definitive answer on that. I can't appeal to any sort of magisterial reference that would provide evidence to justify the claim, yes. So has the church considered it in the past in any views of penal substitution prior to Martin Luther and John Calvin? I would have to do a little bit of research on that before I give any sort of definitive answer as to whether it may have been permitted at some time as a theological opinion, then rejected. But the church, in her articulation of the atonement, is not with regard to the punishment that is bestowed upon Christ because of the major theological implications that are involved in that theological worldview. Rather, the church teaches what is called vicarious satisfaction, which does fit within God's justice because, again, as I said before, the debt of the human race was indeed remitted and or discharged in virtue of the merits of Jesus' death on the cross.
Zachary, thank you. I'm going to keep moving to try to get as many on as I can. Brandon is in Livonia, Michigan, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Brandon, I will ask you to be kind of quick with your question, please.
No problem, guys. I'll be super fast. God bless.
Thank you.
Also want to say that my little girls, Maddie and Lila, are tickled pink that I'm going to be on the radio. So
hey, Maddie and Lila.
Anyway, thanks. Carlo appeals a lot to natural law for things like sexual ethics, contraception. And I'm just wondering why it is that we should be using a thing according to its nature. Why we should presuppose to use something only according to its nature.
Yeah. All right. So fundamentally, it's a presupposition of acting in accord with our own human nature. And that's what the natural moral law properly and primarily refers to. So the question that you're asking, I'm assuming, would apply to using things in accord, using our powers in accord with their natures and their natural ends, which further assumes that we need to just act in accord with human nature itself. Because it's involved within human nature, it's because of our human nature that we have these powers. So I'm going to recommend an article I wrote that answers that very question, Brandon, why human nature is important when evaluating sexual behavior at Catholic.com. And I list these reasons. Human nature determines what's good for us. So given that we're hardwired to choose things only insofar as we perceive what is good for us, we should act in accord with human nature. Because human nature determines what is good for us. If we reject human nature, we reject love, because if you reject human nature, you reject what is good for us. If we reject what is good for us as human beings, then we can't have love. Why? Because to love is to will the good of another. So if you ain't got any good grounded in human nature, then you can't have love. We also evaluate other behaviors, sexual behaviors in particular, in light of human nature. We say slavery is wrong. Why? Because that's an unjust coercion of self-determined beings who have the power to determine themselves. We judge killing the innocent to be wrong based upon the equality of human nature that we have with each other. We judge rape to be wrong. Why? Again, because it's unjustly coercing people who are self-determining beings. And finally, human nature keeps morality objective. But again, those are reasons in summary that I articulate in greater detail in my article, Why Human Nature is Important When Evaluating Sexual Behavior.
I hope you find the article, Brandon. Thank you. It's such a great question for Carlo. I wish we had more time on that.
I know, it's so limited time, yeah.
Maybe we'll get to talk another time. Carlo, thanks very much. Appreciate the hour. I enjoyed the time.
Hey, Cy. Thank you for having me, buddy. God bless.
All right. God bless you as well. That'll do it for us. Hey, tomorrow we're going to talk about women in the church. We've got a special guest, and we're going to talk about the history of women in the church and the church's what the church has meant for women in history and what the women in the church have meant to the church. We'll do that tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.